Good afternoon. It's Tuesday, the 7th of March, 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom Talk. I was going to do one this morning. Sometimes you don't feel it. Do you know what I mean? I didn't feel the show was there this afternoon. I thought, oh, I don't know what sort to talk about today. So I've been swimming, went down the shops a little bit, bought myself a Daily Mail. And there's loads to chat about in here today. Absolutely loads and loads to talk about. So I don't think I'm going to be short of things to talk about this afternoon, boys and girls. All right. First of all, let me tell you about my little trip yesterday to the hospital in London. Oh, yes. I had to get up very early yesterday. 6 o'clock in the morning I got up. Can you believe that? I can't think the last time I saw 6 o'clock in the morning. Unless, of course, I was taking a flight somewhere in the most... not in the last year and a half. When's the last time I flew somewhere? Was it Israel? It was either... No, I think it was Florida. It was Florida with my nephew. I'm sure that's the last time I flew now because I got fed up with flying, as you well know. So I got up at 6 o'clock yesterday morning. Jumped on my bike at 7 o'clock, got to the train station at 7:20. I'd already gone the day before to get my ticket. And that was a good job as well, because, you know, I, busy town train station, one ticket office open. So there's a queue of about 10 people waiting to get their ticket. You see, that would just drive me mad. So I'm so glad I went up there on Sunday night and got myself a train ticket. Train was set to come at 7:32, I think it was. It came 2 minutes late. Jumped on the train, and I got a seat. It was nowhere near as busy as I thought it would be. Certainly not at Bracknell. But as it stopped at the stations going towards London, it gradually was filling up with more and more people. So I guess, yeah, actually, isn't it Bracknell then Reading? So Reading's at the end, isn't it? Then it's Bracknell and then all the stations into, like, yeah, we must be only the second station, or I don't know. There might be another couple in between. But anyway, managed to get a seat. Left the train at Richmond. Now, that's not where it finishes. It finishes at Waterloo. But I had to change onto a different train at Richmond. So I got off that train and I wanted to use the toilet. So I had to go through the barriers, you know, put the ticket in and it comes out the other end, grab the ticket. 20 pence to use the toilet, dear. God's sake, man. And, you know, it's always the same when you go to those toilets on train stations. You get your money ready. There's always someone hanging around, you know, trying to look for coins in their pocket. Have you noticed that? It must be awful. What if you've got no money? What happens? Do they just let you in anyway? Do you say, look, I'm really desperate to use the toilet. No, you need 20 pence. You might as well just wet yourself there and then might defecate on the station. You can't help it, can you? You know, I'm sure it's happened to you where you've been absolutely desperate. I mean, what would happen? Look, I'm desperate to go to the... I've got no money on me. Can you let me in? Would they let you in, I wonder? I'd like to think so. Maybe I could try. I really need to go. Yeah, jump over. I really need to go. God, no, I need to go now. Please open the door. Would that work? Has anyone tried it? Stick a little message there if you've ever tried that one, boys and girls. We'll be opening the phone line a little bit later on, just in case anyone wants to call in. Sometimes we don't get people calling. That's okay. No problem at all. Only if you want to. No one's forced to call in or anything. Maybe you'd like to... I'll open the phone line. If there's something that gets in your head because it's happened to you, please call in and continue the conversation. Phone number's up there now. Okay, if you're watching the show live, you'll see a little live red in the corner. If that light... If there's no live sign, a little red live in the corner, then you're watching a recording, so you can't call in. But if you can see the live sign, you are indeed watching us live, and you can call in on our local London phone number, 020 8144 3477. Okay, 020 8144 3477, or you can Skype in. Our Skype in name is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. So there's the first thing this morning. Have you ever been at a pay toilet, whether it's on a train station or in a shopping centre or anywhere like that? Have you ever been at a paying toilet and you haven't had any money? Has someone let you in, or did you jump over the barrier? I mean, it's only a little barrier like that. I mean, what would happen? That's another thing. What would happen? We ought to get someone from a train station on, shouldn't we? What would happen if you jumped over the barrier at the toilet? Not the trains, not to get on the train without paying. What would happen if you jumped over a barrier to get into a paying toilet? Come on, surely you couldn't get done for that. I think it's outrageous how they got the audacity to charge people to use the toilet at a train station. Danny Davies is calling in. Hello, Danny, in Wales. Hello, Danny, how are you?
Good afternoon. I'm good, thank you. How are you?
All right. Has it happened to you then, Danny?
I've always just kind of crept under the thing when nobody's looking.
But the toilet things, the toilet barriers, have you? And it's never been a problem?
Never been a problem. I've never been stopped because the turnstiles, not gates or anything like that.
That's right. Yes, yes. It's easy to jump over. If I've got 20p, I don't mind putting 20p in, to be honest. But, you know, if you're that desperate, surely if you were spotted going over that barrier, they wouldn't do anything.
Well, it's a human right, isn't it? A toilet, isn't it?
Well, I think so. Either that or you wet yourself, don't you? Eh?
And then they've got to pay someone to clean it up, which is costing them £7 whatever an hour for them to clean it up. So it's
they pay as low as they can, don't they? You know, what makes me mad is the profits some of these train people run. It's unbelievable. What are the trains like in Wales? What line is it there? Is it Virgin?
We have Arriva Trains Wales.
Arriva, okay. Are they quite good?
Well, they're the same as the bus company.
Right, okay.
So they're all owned by a German company, biggest transport company in the world. And they're all right. The trains are a little bit knackered and they're all old trains. They're not like Pendolinos or all these Virgin trains that are quite nice. But
Are they not buying any? I mean, the Germans are very efficient, aren't they? Don't you think? They're efficient. Yeah. Now, there's a German bloke works in Audi. I think Audi is German, isn't there? There's a German bloke who works in that, and he's very polite, but very efficient. And I think there's a very fine line between efficient and rude. He's never rude. He's always very efficient. Good morning, sir. And he don't stop while he's talking. Good morning, sir. How are you today? Beep. You know, very well, thank you. Lovely weather outside, isn't it? Boop. Boop, £3.25. Thank you very much, sir. Have a lovely day. Good morning, madam. And he's straight on to the next one. He's really efficient. And I think the Germans are very efficient people, aren't they? I'm watching this programme at the moment, SSGB, on BBC One Colour on Sunday nights. And there's an SS bloke in it, you know. The story is that the Germans won the war. And they're now in Britain, right? And this German bloke, and they all come across as like really efficient. Never laid back, the SS, are they? Very efficient with those boots and that.
Yeah, they're always very, what's the word? Authoritative as well, aren't they?
Thigh length. Have you got thigh length leather boots that you might wear in private sometimes, Danny? Have you?
No, I don't.
No, nothing like that. No, little white sparkly shorts, perhaps. I mean, which camp do you fall into? You know, is it like the leather boots? Or the camp little white shorts, or the tracksuit. I mean, which ones do you fall into there?
I'm more of a jeans type of or tracksuit bottoms kind of person, really. Jeans or tracksuit bottoms.
Boring,
I'm not really,
really
into like leather or.
Bit boring, really, aren't you? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, just a bog standard guy, you know what I mean? Well, I am Welsh.
There's nothing wrong with Wales. I'd happily move to North Wales, but I don't think they like the English there, do they? Is that about right? If I was to move into a little village in Wales where they speak Welsh, I wouldn't be welcome, would I? Bill, be honest now. I wouldn't be welcome.
Well, the thing is, it depends on what part of North Wales you'd be moving to. If you move to Wrexham, then it wouldn't be a problem because nobody would kind of. No, because we kind of speak. We don't have that Welsh twang.
Oh,
but
do you
if
not?
You move to South Wales,
Welsh twang.
Yeah, you know, like
I like the accent. I love accents. I love the Irish accent, Welsh accent. I think the Liverpool accent for me is the sexiest accent. The Liverpool accent.
I'm like that. I do like a Scouser.
Yeah, most accents in the world I like. There's one particular accent that really grates me. South African. I don't like that accent at all. It just, I don't know what it is. There's something about that South African accent. And if you're very, very Scottish, the accent's okay, but I have a real job understanding you. Isn't that funny?
Yeah, it's because they speak a little bit too quick, because my sister's partner's Scottish.
All right, yeah. Where's he from?
He's from Edinburgh.
Okay, yeah.
So he talks quite quick.
That's a lovely city, say, that is. Have you been?
I've been to Glasgow. I've never been to Edinburgh. I've been to Glasgow.
Oh, Edinburgh is much nicer. It's a beautiful city. The architecture and all the buildings and all that there are just stunning. They really are.
I'd love to go to, because as you know, last year I was working for a well-known radio station.
Well, why don't you just say it? I don't understand why people do that. Just say it. Just say it. I was eating a well-known chocolate bar. I was going to a well-known supermarket that use orange as their logo. Why don't they just say Sainsbury's? Just get on with it. Say it, dear. Say it.
Okay. Well, I was working for Gadio last year. I'm not sure if you've heard about it.
Are they still on air, dear? Unbelievable. Yeah. Yes, carry on.
10 years they've been going.
Good God, dear.
And I was fortunate to be with them when they had their birthday last year in the top of the biggest tower in Manchester. Anyway, so last summer we did a promotion called the Big Summer Out. And we went to 5 of the biggest prides in the UK. So I went to London, Manchester, Birmingham, Glasgow and Brighton. So I managed to go to all of those. Can you imagine me, 5 prides? I was prided out by the time it come to.
Oh, I bet you were adding that. I would do my head in all that happening. Don't do it for me at all, pride anymore. That thing. Which one did you find the best, Brighton?
No, Birmingham. Birmingham was the best.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Fair enough.
Because I've been to Birmingham a few times and... You know, when I was used to go as a normal person, you'd see the
a normal person. When have you ever been normal?
Well, you know what I mean. It's
oh, hang on a minute. No, you're quite right. Jeans and t-shirt. Yeah, nothing exciting going on there. Normal.
So when I used to go as a normal person, and not a you know, working for the media,
right?
You'd always used to be standing in crowds waiting for this, that and the other. But when you work for the media, this is what I think is a bit wrong. If you work for the media, you get preferential treatment.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, they do. Yeah. I mean, these people from newspapers, even BBC's the best. They just swish in. Oh, we're BBC, and they swish in. I wouldn't have none of that. If I was on the door somewhere, I said, oh, we're BBC. Yeah, £5 each, please. Yeah, but what, BBC? Yeah, £5 each, please. I wouldn't have any of that. Wouldn't have any of that at all.
At Birmingham, because we were a supporter for all the big 5 prides, we got AAA passes at every single one.
Oh, right.
So we get to go backstage, and then we'd only have to go to the bar for a drink, and there'd be like 5 people back. You know what busy bars are like on the weekends.
Yes, over
the years. You'd walk with an AAA pass to a bar, they'd serve you straight away. I think that's a bit wrong. Because why should you get... You've not paid for that privilege.
Do you know, I've got no interest in that at all. None at all. Any of the prides going just doesn't do it for me at all.
But...
Just an excuse for one big drunk party. That's all it is.
Yeah, it is. But I enjoyed it, but this year...
You're of the
going
age.
On a cruise.
Of course you enjoy it. You're of the age. You're going on a cruise, did you say?
They're doing a cruise this year, yeah.
Oh, right. Who are?
Gadio.
Oh, okay. You're going on that, are you?
I'm not too sure yet.
Go and get yourself a little pair of Speedos. Sure. You look wonderful around that pool.
Well, it's we fly to Barcelona from Gatwick. And then it's a 7-night Mediterranean cruise.
I hope you don't have any problem with the toilets there.
There won't be any toilet problems, I can assure you.
Danny, thanks for calling in, my good friend, all right?
Take care now.
Cheerio, Danny in Wexham, Wales. Bye-bye, Danny. Oh. There we are. So Danny's had the problem. He just dumped over the barrier to use the toilet. Anyone else? Anyone else had toilet problems at a toilet that you've got to pay to go into but didn't have the money? What did you do? Did you just jump over or did you scream, "Hello, I want to use the toilet, hurry up"? Then let us know. Call in and let me know. 020-8144-3477. Adam the Plumber's calling in now. Good afternoon, Adam. What are your toilet experiences? Oh, can we just say happy birthday to your mum? A belated birthday.
Thank you very much, Chris.
Perhaps I should sing it to her. Do you think I should sing it to her?
You could do, yes.
Perhaps her son should sing it to her as well, although there might be a bit of delay by the time the music gets to you. let's give it a go. What's her name?
Pat.
Here we go. Sing along with me, Adam.
Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Pat. Happy birthday to you. Adam's mum has become a viewer. Happy birthday, Pat, darling. All right, there we are. Especially for your mum. And what did you do for your mum's birthday?
Went up there for a Sunday roast.
A family roast? Oh, did she cook it?
She did, yes.
Well, you should have gone there then and cooked it for her.
Oh, God, no, she'd never let me near her cooker.
And let me just ask you, you know, as you are on a diet at the moment at Slimming World, what did you have? A piece of carrot? Perhaps a pea or two?
I had one pea and one carrot. No, I had... Unfortunately, with my mum's roast, you have all or nothing, so I had it all.
But it's only once. It's only once, isn't it? I've just weighed myself, actually, before I come up here. £2. I've gone down £2. Yeah.
Good.
And Wendy, the lovely Wendy, has told me that she can see the weight loss. That's the only thing with weight loss. It tends to go off your face first, doesn't it? Have you noticed that?
It does, yes.
If only it left my stomach or arse first, I'd be much happier, to be honest.
Yeah, but the nice thing is nobody really sees your arse on the radio show, on the TV show, do they?
At this present moment in my life, that's probably a good thing, Adam. I am thinking of wearing longer shirts when I'm hosting my karaoke and quiz nights at the moment. You know, last night as I got off, you know, as I got left the pub, which is right next to a busy road, and I stopped for a moment, and three people grabbed my bum and they thought I was a bus and were trying to enter me. But never
number
mind.
73.
Tell us your toilet issues. What happened? Where was it? And what happened?
I don't have any because I work for the railways, don't I? So I get free all the time.
Right.
But I have seen people jump in the barriers and they get told off.
Oh, they do get told off then?
Yeah, not by me, but by the toilet attendants.
Yeah, but surely they can't get off. If you're desperate, what else are you supposed to do?
Well, I think there's a sort of unspoken rule, you know, they sort of let you get away with it, but they shouldn't.
I mean, if
the money that goes in, the money from these toilets goes into repairing them.
Oh, right. Okay.
It does nothing else but other... and reinvest back into those toilets and other toilets on the network.
Right. I mean, I understand that, you know. I mean, if you've got someone who kept doing it, then fair enough. Mm-hmm. But if you know someone you don't know, suddenly you see them jump over the barrier. I mean, presumably they don't chase them into the toilet, do they? I mean, surely they'd wait for them to come back out again.
Yeah, they wait for them to come back out and say, you know, why did you jump that?
But it would be very, very strange if someone was being followed into a toilet, I think, lovey.
I'm not having any
funny business like that when I'm using the toilets, if you don't mind me saying so.
No, no, I mean, that would never happen to you.
Thank you.
I did have an amusement the other day, though. There was this young lad that thought he'd jumped the turnstile at Brighton.
Yeah.
Totally missed it and ended up flat on his face.
Oh, I would like to have seen, I'd paid to have seen that. Why didn't you have your video camera out? You could have sent it here to the United Kingdom Talk Television Complex and that could have been edited into one of our little shows.
It could have been, but unfortunately I wasn't with camera at time.
Yeah. Oh, but, well.
No, but the I mean, the money that goes in, it literally goes for servicing and maintenance of the toilets. I mean, a lot of people don't realise how expensive it is to run those toilets. You know, I mean, from the start, there's the building itself, which they're losing in revenue for shops, which could be shops. That's the first thing. Then there's the cleaning staff. There's all the water they use. Then there's the vandalism.
Yeah, I expect there's a lot of that, isn't there?
I mean, they have to have specially made toilet seats for the toilets, and they cost around about £200 each seat.
Well, because people just rip them up. Why do people do that? Why? Mm. What is it that with people that go in toilets and rip pipes off walls or pull up toilet? What the hell is all that about?
I have no idea. Over the years, I've seen lots of it. I've seen everything from doors being kicked off to actual total toilet. I mean, we had an incident. I think it was about a year and a half ago.
Yes.
And
what was that noise?
That was my work phone.
I thought it was your stomach. It sounded like your stomach. I thought you were speaking from a toilet for a moment, dear.
So, we had an incident a couple of years ago.
Yes.
Where somebody was having an argument with their girlfriend on the phone, and they were in the toilet at the time, and they totally lost it with the argument and ended up smashing up the entire toilet, which had just been finished being refitted.
No self-control, people.
I think that cost in the region of... He was arrested. That cost in the region of about £6,000 to put right.
Gosh. Well, it just shows you then that 20p...
Literally destroyed it.
Is that round about what it is generally, 20 pence or some dearer, I would imagine?
10-20 pence, yeah. It's not a lot.
No.
You know, but every coin helps, obviously. Keep it running, you know.
Yeah.
Pays my wages.
Do you fix the toilets on the train? Is that a specialist thing?
No, that'll get started in the workshops.
Right.
Then they go back into the sidings.
Okay.
There's big sidings and workshops all over the UK that take the trains in, and they get repaired there. But I actually look after all the station buildings.
Right.
I look after all the station buildings, so anything from the ticket office to the actual platform toilets themselves.
Okay. That's a nice little job you've got, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
You certainly get to travel, don't you?
Certainly do, up and down the country, in and out all the ladies and gents' toilets. It's certainly see some interesting things, I can say.
Do you ever travel on the trains themselves, or have you just got a van that you have to go from place to place?
I've got a van, but when I used to do the London Midland contract, which was between sort of Euston, Tring...
My aunt lives in Tring, Auntie Brenda.
Yeah.
She lives in Tring.
So I've been to that station quite a few times, Tring Station, and Berkhamsted and all up that way.
Yeah.
And sometimes it was like we used to get a regular one at Berkhamsted that used to block all the time. There's a toilet there that used to block at least once a week.
Right.
And it was because it was a defective pan. When it had been moulded in the factory, the outlet hole where all the waste goes was too small. It had been mismoulded.
I had an incorrect toilet installed at my house, actually, years ago when I had the bathroom done. And if you had a wee, that would be okay. You would flush the toilet and off it would go. Mm. Anything other than wee, you'd flush a toilet and it would still be there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was my mate who fitted this thing.
All right.
And I'm like, well, I said, this isn't working. He said, well, I don't understand it. It's all level and everything. Mm. Anyway, I got someone else in who took one look. He said, oh, that one needs needs a motor or something.
Really?
I said, well, how do you know that? He said, can you see the two prongs at the bottom there? Yeah. He said, that one needs not a motor, a masher thing.
A macerator.
A macerator. It needs a macerator attached to it. And that's why, of course, it wasn't going down. It would be all right if you got a bucket of water, that would be okay, but it wouldn't flush down. How awful not to have a flushing toilet, dear.
Indeed. That is not good.
No.
There is actually a simple test you can do to see the performance of your toilet is flushing.
Oh, yes.
Correctly.
Well, go on, tell us what the test is. Oh, no, it's been cut off at that moment. How annoying. I want to know how to test my toilet. Oh, I'm disappointed. He'll call back again in a minute. I'm sure he will. Adam the plumber calling in about his toilets. Right, shall I carry on with the story? We've talked enough about... I don't know how we got into the sun. We've been talking 26 minutes about toilets. How did that happen? Anyway, so got to Richmond Station, came out of the station to use the toilet, went back through the barrier and literally walked straight on to the next train that was waiting. And within 2 minutes, off it went. Once again, I've just sat straight down. It's now about 8:15 in the morning. So peak travel time, I suppose you would say. Peak travel time. But it wasn't full up. Nowhere near full up. There weren't like hundreds of people standing because they couldn't sit down or anything like that. So I'm sitting on there. Everything running to time. I got to Hampstead Heath Station just before 9 o'clock. Oh, excuse me, I got hiccups. Just before 9 o'clock. Left the station there and I put my ticket in and it didn't come back out again. And there was a guard there. I said, oh, are these tickets supposed to come out? He said, did you get a single? I said, no, I got a return. Oh, hang on a minute, I've got two tickets. So you get an out and an in. He said, I said, ah, yes, I've still got the out ticket here. He said, yeah, it keeps the other one. Okay, thank you very much. Left the station, crossed over the road, walked up to the hospital, Royal Free Hospital I was going to in London. Went in there, they've got this self-service check-in thing. Now, I mentioned this on a show a couple of days ago. I'm not too keen. You know, you've got this screen and you start touching it. Well, how many germs and bacteria are ingrained onto that nasty little TV screen? Vile, dear. Anyway, so it asks you your date of birth. So February the 5th. And then straight away it came up, are you so-and-so? Are you Chris Reardon? Yes. Click yes. Date of birth. What was it? Date of, I can't remember what else. And you just push things. And it said go to clinic. I think it was clinic 5. So, oh, I didn't know where that was. Excuse me, where's clinic 5? Yeah, it's on the first floor. Went up to the first floor. It's now about 9:15. Okay, I've also stopped to get myself a cup of tea. I walked past Starbucks, a queue a mile long, to the tea place just outside the hospital. And there's no one in there. 9 o'clock in the morning. I thought, oh, it's going to be a queue. Not a soul in there. So I went in there. A nice man in there served me a cup of tea. So I got my little cup of tea, gone in the hospital, checked in, gone up to the first floor. And there's a desk up there. And the two receptionists, you know, you just stand there in front of the reception and they completely ignore you, don't they? No one says, you know, oh, we'll be with you in a minute or anything like that, do they? Nothing at all. So I said, I've checked in downstairs. Do you need to see this at all? No, that's okay. You can just sit over there now. Okay. So I'm there about 5 minutes. The appointment was for 9:50. It's 9:15. So very happy that I'm plenty of time. It never bothers me that I've got somewhere too early because you can just sit there and you haven't got to worry that you're late or anything because I can't bear being late. I really can't stand being late. And I don't like other people that make me late sometimes. You know, where you might have an appointment for 3 o'clock and, I don't know, someone said, oh, well, we won't need to leave till so-and-so. Well, if you need to leave at 2 o'clock for a 3 o'clock appointment, I want to leave at 1:30 in case anything goes wrong. And you sit there having a row with them. Oh, no. Well, OK, that's all right. I'll go on my own or whatever. I like to be somewhere earlier than the appointment. That's just me, right? You know, besides, with the NHS, you know what it's like. People don't turn up for appointments this, that, and that. And there's always a good chance you're going to get seen earlier anyway, as was the case here. So I'm sitting there drinking my tea, looking at work, and then I heard a name. Mr. Reardon, please. And I thought, oh, you know, and at that point, of course, the lid drops off the cup, doesn't it? So I'm on the floor, picking the lid up, put it back up. Mr. Reardon, I've got up, right, and I'm looking around. Oh, I think I just heard my name called. The two receptionists look up. You know, one great big fat thing with glasses and the other one with multicoloured hair looked at me as if I was some sort of idiot. I said, did I just hear my name? Oh, it was probably someone with the same name. Go and sit back down. Well, I'm sure I heard my name. I mean, how many Reardons can there be in there on the same day at that particular clinic having their stomach looked at? Oh, no, I'm sure no one, I'm sure they've, the person has just, and someone said to me, oh, someone's just gone in. Oh, well, maybe it was then. So I sat back down, a bit dubious about that. 5 minutes later, I heard my name again, and this time I could see an elderly, an older nurse type person was there. Mr. Reardon, oh, yeah, that's me. Okay, so I went over, did you just call my name a few minutes ago? She said, yes. She said, I did. And an Italian man stood up. When I looked at him, I thought it didn't look like a Reardon. I mean, what does a Reardon look like? I don't know. Ah, that I know. She would have recognised my voice from this television programme. That's it. She must have been one of my viewers, but too embarrassed to say anything. That's what I reckon. So she said, yes, it was the wrong man. I said, do you know, I asked those people if anyone had called Reardon, and they just looked at me as if it was some other planet. Anyway, she was really nice, this old nurse lady. So I had a bit of a chat with her. She said, so she went in there, she took my height and my weight. And then she said, if you sit back there, a doctor will call you very shortly. Okay. So about 5 minutes later, a door opened and this lady called me in. So I went in there. So she'd be like a gastroenterologist specialist. You know, a doctor that's especially with stomach. So I explained to her the problems that were going on and this, that and the other. And I was in there 15, 20 minutes. She didn't examine me at all. She just listened to everything that I had to say. And she's decided that there's nothing wrong. It's just that over time, the habits of my bowel have changed. Nothing really to do with the top part of the stomach at all. One of the main things that she's decided is that I am basically filling up with air, which is probably due to too much fibre in my diet. What do I eat? Hello? Well, I'm vegetarian, I said to her. Ah, she says. She said, well, that's not a bad thing, but it will be part of the problem. There's something that you're eating that is making you fill up with air. And I mentioned the fact that, you know, on this side, I can lay on my front and it feels like you're laying on a pillow, literally. And then you turn over on your back and gradually that feeling moves around the back and it feels like you've got a pillow up that part of your back. She said, it's air. She said, I'm pretty sure it's air. And it will be something you're eating. Do you know anything that is particular at causing it? I said, yes, I know definitely onions. When I have onions, it comes up and goes down. Or it comes up, you know, by the morning. Okay, so that's when I go to bed. By the morning, generally, it's gone. It's not there anymore. It's just so damn annoying when you're in the... Oh, can't get bloody... What is that under there? And there's nothing there. Only me. Me and my pocket of air. So no camera. So I said, I don't need the camera then. She said, no, not at all. She said, don't need to put a camera down. There's nothing to look for. Oh, I thought, fantastic. Because I really, really didn't want that. And she said, I could get you to see a dietitian. I'll ring you in a few months and see how you're getting on. And basically, that was it. I was very happy with the doctor. She was lovely. Middle-aged lady, I suppose. But she was lovely. She appeared to know exactly what she was talking about. I have a great respect for GPs. You know, the family GPs and all that. But they're not specialists in things. So when you go to see a specialist in a particular sphere, in this case, stomachs, gastroenterology or whatever it's called. And she speaks and she spoke quite well. Like there was no, oh, I don't really know what that is. There was none of that. She came across as knowing exactly what she talked about. And that's what you want. I was having a chat with my mate today at the swimming pool. I don't mind doctors being abrupt or sharp. If they know what they're talking about, then that's what you want, isn't it? You know, none of this, don't really know what that is. I mean, that doesn't exactly fill you with confidence. She did. She wasn't abrupt. She was lovely, that doctor. And she completely filled me with confidence. And that's it, really. So it's an air issue. It seems to be an air issue. And I've got to watch what I eat. Now, interestingly enough, the last 2 days, of course, I've been very, very busy. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. And I haven't really had many vegetables. I've been doing sort of a quick eating. Now, you know, at the moment for Lent, I've cut out bread, all bread except Maureen's lovely sandwiches. I can't say no to Maureen's sandwiches on a Monday and Friday. And she likes doing them anyway. So I thought, no, I'll carry on eating it. So I just eat bread on the Monday and the Friday in the form of a couple of sandwiches. There's no bread, there's no crisps. There's no cakes, there's no chocolate, okay? But the last 2 or 3 days, I haven't really had many vegetables. It's been like spaghetti bolognese, that sort of thing, you know, was spaghetti arrabbiata. That's a vegetarian one. There's no meat in it. And I've not had the problem. This has not, this at the moment, right, I'm laying back. There's nothing there whatsoever. And I haven't had any vegetables. Now, it's not good not to have vegetables. I've had a few bananas, which are classed as like the one a day. I've had two or three of those a day now. I'm going to probably have one with a cup of tea when I finish today's show, actually. But I haven't blown up at all. So I think there's something. What I tend to do with vegetables, I'm a bit lazy. I buy the little plastic boxes of them, you know. And there's like layers, there's sweet corn, broccoli, peas, carrots. It might be one of those items or two, whatever, that is causing the problem. So maybe I could go out and buy these things separately, and just to try out for a week, on Tuesday, I'll have the peas. On Wednesday, I'll just have carrots. On Thursday, I think I'll have just a broccoli. Now, I think it could be the broccoli. What do you reckon? The broccoli is like very finely cut up. So that's it, really. I left there quite happily. I had to go to another department afterwards, because I've been getting big red patches, enormously itchy, appearing in the roof of my mouth. And I went to see another doctor that I'm on there. I'm under there for something else. And he looked up there and he said, he said, do you use an inhaler? I said, yes. He said, what is it, the steroid one? I said, yes, the brown one. He said, are you using a spacer with it? And I'm like, no. He said, I bet you that's what it is. I said, now, hang on a minute. I think that's making sense to me. Because this little brown inhaler, I'm supposed to have one puff in the morning and one in the evening. And it stops you needing to use the blue one most of the time. Sometimes you use it. I can go months without touching the blue one. And then sometimes it kicks off a little bit. But generally, the brown one is a preventer to stop you using the blue one. Okay. Now, you are supposed to use this thing with a spacer. Now, I haven't got one to show you, but basically you put the brown, instead of putting the brown thing straight in your mouth, which I've been doing, and you go like that. Instead of doing that, you're supposed to have this big plastic thing in the middle. So you go, and then it goes through there, does something, mixes it with the air or something, and then goes down your throat or down your windpipe. Now, if you're only using the brown thing straight into your mouth, then that jet of stuff, that steroids, hits the back of your throat somewhere, doesn't it? And that is damaging the roof of my mouth. And as soon as he said that, I thought, you know what? I believe that. And I'll tell you why. Because I had been having it at a certain angle, you know, like that. And I was getting these little red dots coming up in the roof of my mouth, and sometimes a big red patch. And I thought, if I angle it differently, perhaps downwards, so that the spray, whatever it is, because steroid stuff, goes straight down my throat, surely that will stop the roof of the mouth going like that. And it did. The only thing was, I got a massive painfully itchy, not painful, itchy like mad. Right at the back of the throat. You know that thing that hangs down at the back of your throat? And that had gone all red. And when he said that, I thought, yes, well, I've moved that, and now it's affected the back of my throat. So it's got to be that. It's absolutely got to be that. So now I've got to get another spacer from the doctor. So I'm actually waiting for them to ring me up and let me know. I don't know. Well, maybe you can buy one off Amazon or something like that. I did speak to the doctor this morning. Not the doctor, the prescription lady. And apparently there's all different types. So you've got to get the right one for your little thing. She didn't know what it was. So someone in the prescription service is going to ring me at some point this afternoon, actually. And then she'll be able to prescribe me that, and I should go and pick one up. And until then, I'm not going to use that brown one. So I'll just have to hope that the asthma stays under control. I mean, I've always got the blue one. You are supposed to use the brown one. And that's where I am at the moment. So there we are. Then I got back. I went back to the train station, got straight on the train again, amazingly. You know, 2 minutes later, a train came, got back off on the train, got to Richmond, and by now, I'm way ahead of time. Way ahead. It was something like a quarter past 11, half past 11, something like that I got back to Richmond station. And I thought, you know, I feel really hungry now, because I hadn't eaten in the morning. I didn't want to eat because of the antibiotics I've been taking, which are finished this morning, actually. I've got one left over. I can't work that out. I must have done something wrong at some point because I was supposed to have two penicillin tablets four times a day. And I've got one left over. So I don't know why I've got one single thing left over. So I've just finished those now. But they were giving me a bit of a problem where you had to run to the toilet a few times. So I didn't eat this morning. So now I'm really hungry. So I popped into a Cornish pasty place. Now, what a blooming expensive as well. £3.75 for a vegetable pasty and a cheese and onion. That's each. £3.75 each. I was starving. So I had a vegetable wholemeal pasty. From this Cornish pasty company or something like that, and a cheese and onion one, and a cup of tea, which came to about £8 or £9. I didn't mind paying because I was starving, so I sat there and ate those. They were delicious, actually, and they're very big. They're very big. You don't need two, to be honest. The one would have been enough. So I sat there and took time easy, watching the people running around on the train station. Then I went over the bridge at Richmond Station, back onto platform one. Again, as I'm going down the stairs, the train was announced. I haven't had to wait anywhere. I got back on the train. That was quite empty. You know, it's 11 o'clock in the morning. There's not many people on the trains. There's a few of us on there. Read my book, my radio book, which I bought Ray Reynolds a copy of my that radio book I told you about the other day. It's really good. Very, very funny indeed. Got back on my bike and arrived home, I don't know, about 1:45, 1:00 in the afternoon. Fantastic day. And now my mind is at ease, you know, nothing really to worry about, nothing at all. It's just that air thing. So I need to find out what's causing it. All right, that was my day yesterday. I know you were so worried about me, weren't you? Yes, indeed you were, I can tell. Let's do some of your messages today, boys and girls. Let's see who's with. I haven't done any messages at all yet, have I, actually? Just a minute. Let's just find out where you all are. Is that the one there? That's it. Right, okay, let's say hello to Tim Partington. Tim, karaoke friend. Adam, we just spoke to a little while ago. Jerry's with us. Hello, Jerry Green. Jerry Millen says it's always 30p to go to the loo. It's silly why you would pay to go to the loo. Well, it's not like you can go outside and go round the back, is it? There's just nowhere else to go. You have to pay the money, Jerry, and that's it. Tim says, you think 20 pence toilets are bad? It's 30 pence at Liverpool Street, 50 pence at Trocadero, and 50 pence at St. Christopher's Place. God's sake, it's too expensive. Good afternoon to Vectis, who says it's not in the corner, it's in the middle. What, the live thing? The live thing is in the corner, isn't it? Isn't it in the top left corner? There's a question for you. Where is your live? The little thing on the screen that says we're live, which you'll only see if you're watching a show live. Isn't it in the top? I'm sure it's in the top left-hand corner. Is it in the middle? Where is it for you? Let us know, boys and girls. Tim says sometimes it's free at Liverpool Street because the barrier isn't working. Oh, well, good. Good, good. Danny was on a very clear line this morning, Danny. You or Adam, rather. Oh, Danny. No, Danny. Oh, you mean Danny in Wales. No, Danny has got, I'm not quite sure what phone he's got, but it sounds like he's using a microphone. His phone is one of the clearest I've ever heard. The worst phones that are calling in at the moment are iPhone 7s. We have a lot of trouble with iPhone 7s because they seem to, you've only got to move the phone slightly and you lose it. You completely lose it. It is BBC One colour, Tim. I will continue to say BBC One colour. Thank you very much. Tim says his sister lives in Wales. Oh, I meant to say, Carl Waring, who's a regular viewer to this show, corrects me once again. I said within normal perimeters. It's normal parameters, apparently. Parameters. Thank you, Carl, for your correction. I'll keep saying it as I like it, though. Zach says, good afternoon, Chris. You always give me an excuse to have a little break at work. A little break? It's an hour long, this show, dear. It gets longer every day. Good afternoon to Alan. We've still got Adam's picture up there, haven't we? Let's get rid of that. There we are. Sorry, Adam. I keep forgetting to take people's pictures off when they're there. Incidentally, those of you that watch a recording of the show may notice the picture has changed. We now use the exact recording that has been used for the live. I don't do it now on a separate camera, which also incidentally means at the moment you get the countdown at the beginning. Although I gather a lot of you enjoy the countdown music, so that's not too much of a bad thing. But if you get fed up doing the countdown, just go forward 5 minutes and it's as easy as that. It saved me an awful lot of time being able to use the direct recording from the computer rather than having to do it on another phone, okay? Let's see. Alan says, I don't think I've ever seen you run to the toilet at Central Station. Have you got time to go? What? No, you don't see me run. I'll try to make it look as relaxed as possible, even when I'm dying to go. Because I don't want someone like you, Alan, say, oh, look, it's running to the toilet. Because that's the sort of thing you do to get a laugh, isn't it? Thank you, Adam. Good afternoon to Katie Bonwick. Hello, Katie. And Dennis Granger is there, who says that's cheap for pasties. Try getting them in Cornwall. You need a mortgage. Well, how much are the pasties in Cornwall then? They must be really expensive in Cornwall, are they? Blimey. Dear me. Carl says it's in the middle. Tim says it's in the corner. Now, isn't that strange? So some of you get the live thing in the corner, some of you get it in the middle. Well, that is very strange and mysterious, isn't it? Yes, indeed. That was my day yesterday. Very pleased. Nothing to report, OK? Now, sports fans. I'm not a sports fan. I'm really, really not a sports fan. But look at this. Now, if you are a sports fan, British Telecom, so if you've got this BT Sport Television, is that what it's called? My sister's got BT Vision. I'm really, really not impressed by that at all. Oh, God. You can be watching a programme, then suddenly it starts, you know, that the whirring thing. Buffering, isn't it? Buffering. Most annoying. Anyway, UEFA's pursuit of maximum revenue from their Channel League TV, from their league television rights, saw them use a terrestrial bid for the highlights to hike up the price of a what? Now, listen to this. How is this for numbers? For £1.182 billion monopoly agreement with BT Sport. I think it's disgusting. I think it's absolutely disgusting the amount of money that football clubs are now making. And if you're a fan, what I feel particularly disgusted about is how a father with two boys who are into football, how on earth do they afford to go out and enjoy a football match on a Saturday or something like that? Now, I know how much it costs because my nephew goes, he's in Lincolnshire. So what he does, sometimes he gets the train or takes the car in. Generally, the train. He'll get a train down from Lincolnshire is it Stamford Bridge or somewhere like that? And he must say goodbye to £100, £150 just to go and see a football match. You know, it's disgusting. And it's just going up and up. And the part of the problem is the TV stations, OK? Because they're trying to outbid each other. And half the problem is the football clubs because they're so bloody greedy. The auction for the Champions League and Europa League rights that started last Wednesday went to a second round of bids yesterday, the announcement yesterday. ITV, who were only interested in a highlights package, increased their offer significantly during the final negotiations. But UEFA preferred to take the highest offer on the table for all packages, including the highlights that are currently on ITV. UEFA's decision to sell the whole of the European football rights package to pay TV will frustrate many fans who can't, now listen, who cannot afford a subscription. It's outrageous. Outrageous. I told you, I'm not interested in football in the slightest. But what about these blokes, you know, who are on low-paid jobs or something like that? They can't afford the subscriptions for the televisions. Can they? It's shocking how much money is going on here in football. Someone should do something about this. And meanwhile, they all get richer and richer. The managers, the football club owners, the footballers themselves, unless you're a small club somewhere. It's disgusting. ITV Sport, BT's It comes despite desperate viewing figures on BT, with just over 150,000 people watching Leicester beat Bruges to reach the knockout stages. BT's £1.182 billion outlay is a 32% rise on the £897 million they paid for the current contract that has one season to run. ITV Sport, after making such an effort to retain the highlights, could not hide their dismay. Controller of Sport said, "We're disappointed that UEFA have chosen to ignore the very strong free-to-air coverage ITV have delivered. BT have no plans to sublicense their content to free-to-air TV platforms before the start of the new deal." It's outrageous, isn't it? It's outrageous. But you know what? I think at some point, this will all come collapsing down. People just will not pay for it. I mean, I know pubs pay an absolute small fortune. When you go and watch your football in the local pub, it is costing them an arm and a leg to have it on in there. It really is. And there's some more in the Daily Mail that goes on about it. It says both BT and Sky, which is paying billions for the Premier League games, have imposed a series of inflation-beating price rises across their services in recent years. Customers and consumer groups have blasted BT for putting up charges three times in 18 months. They're so bloody greedy. What is it all about? What is it all about? It says BT services will increase prices across its services again on April the 2nd in what is a third set of rises in 18 months. There's the broadband providers, an extra £2 more, extra £2.50 for fibre. Standard landline and mobiles will jump 1p a minute. BT Sport, here we go. BT Sport, previously included as a free extra, will cost BT TV customers £3.50 a month. So, I don't know, that's not too bad, is it? BT broadband users who will use a Skybox, however, to watch BT Sport will pay an extra £1.50 a month to the existing £7.50 fees. So I don't know, but it's all money, money, money. And, you know, it's particularly sad. I find it particularly sad because if you're of an age like myself, you will remember when all this stuff was free on BBC One, Colour, on ITV, you would just turn your television on a Saturday afternoon, a Saturday night, a Sunday morning, a Sunday afternoon, and it would just be there. It's the greed that gets me. It's not even expensive. It's just bloody well extortionate. The money that is going on in football. And I just think at some point, there it will come to a point and then people, oh, well, we're not paying this anymore. And it'll all come collapsing down. And then everyone's a loser. It's all short-termism. There's a bloke on the radio, actually, Nick Abbott, who's on LBC on Friday, on Saturdays, and I think, is it Saturday nights? Friday nights or Saturday nights? Saturday... Oh, I can't remember now. He's on, yeah, Friday nights and Saturday nights. And he says, what will kill the world and the human population is short-termism. Everything is nothing is looked at long-term anymore, is it? It's all short-termism, as is indeed, you know, it's this football thing. How much can we squeeze out of everyone? Tim says at least the horse racing on ITV is still free, albeit on inferior ITV. I'm not really into horse racing, so I can't comment on that, Tim. I don't really know much about horse racing at all. All right. Anyway, we'll wrap up there today, boys and girls. Thank you very much for watching the show today. We've got some birthdays today, just a couple of birthdays. Jaden Cornelius, it's his birthday today. Lovely little picture of you with your little dog there. That's a very different look you've got now, isn't it, Jaden? Happy birthday to you, sir. And Darren Cavill is 46 years old today. Happy birthday, Darren. I better do yesterday's birthdays. Because we weren't here yesterday, were we, boys and girls? Let's just go back to yesterday. What is it, 7? So it's 6. Yesterday, birthdays on the 6th. How many have we got there? Oh, that's gone wrong, isn't it? No, where's the 6? Birthdays, 6. Siobhan Cracknell, that was her birthday yesterday. We got Susie Pleb Quinnell. Happy birthday, Susie. We got Michael Holt. who was 22 years old yesterday. I've known Michael since he was, I think, about 14 or 15, 13, 14 or 15. And he used to call in the radio. So when I did a on Play Radio, which was down on the South Coast, I used to do a show on there. And Mikey used to call in there. Happy birthday, Mikey. He's doing really well in his life. And Troy James today is, yesterday was 47 years old yesterday. So let's sing the song, boys and girls. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you. All right, gang. Have a lovely time on your birthdays, everyone, boys and girls. That's it for the show today. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I'm going to go downstairs now and have another cup of tea and a banana. Enjoy. Bye-bye now.